inside us, now broken down in Jesus. And though we are still different, He makes us one. No one better than another. We all need faith in Jesus, for only He can save us. He makes us one. We are yours, we belong, every daughter, every son. We are one, we're the family of God. Rich and poor, old and young, every nation, every tongue. We are one, we're the family of God. We were dead in sin and helpless, now made alive.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I delight in seeing each of your faces. It is so wonderful when we can gather together as a family of God and worship God with one voice and one heart. Whatever you bring today, know that the Lord is ready to receive it. And I hope as you come today, you're ready to receive from God. Would you join me in prayer? We come ready to receive, Lord, whatever you have for us, whatever is going to transform us, whatever is going to bring us healing and comfort, whatever is going to bring us strength and hope, whatever is going to eradicate the things in us that do harm to others. We come ready to receive a word of comfort, a word of conviction, a word of transformation, a word of peace, a word of love. We come into your presence knowing that you are with us, as close as our very breath. We come to worship you. We come for you. And we know that we can worship you wherever we find ourselves, but there's something about coming together and joining our voices and our hearts together that both encourages us and delights you and brings you glory. May you be glorified in the songs that we sing, in the prayers that we lift up. May you be glorified in our conversations with one another. May you be glorified in the things that we do when we leave this place, in the ways that we are the church when we leave this building. May you be glorified. May Christ be seen in and through us. May you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you join me in the responsive reading as it appears on the screen?
Listen, listen for the voice of God, naming us all, holy, beloved, cherished, valued. Make us people who recognize and proclaim your beauty and goodness in unexpected places. We trust in you, Holy One, to reveal to us the sacredness of every life, of every way of being, of every physical manifestation of your Spirit. Amen.
I invite you to worship through song. You're welcome to stand or to sit, to kneel. You're welcome to clap or to dance, to raise your hands, or to simply sit and allow the words to soak into your spirit, making them your prayer to God who loves us. Let us worship in spirit and in truth.
Interesting. Now, Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at that time. She held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim. And the Israelites went up to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abimoam from Kadesh and Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go, take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead them up to Mount Tabor. I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River and give him into your hands." Barak said to her, "If you go with me, I will go. But if you don't go with me, I won't go." "Certainly I will go with you," said Deborah. "But because of the course you are taking, the honor will not be yours. For the Lord will deliver Sisera into the hands of a woman." Barak pursued the chariots and army as far as Harosheth Hagoyim, and all Sisera's troops fell by the sword. Not a man was left. Sisera, meanwhile, fled on foot to the tent of Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite. Because there was an alliance between Jabin, king of Hazor, and the family of Heber the Kenite. Jael went out to meet Sisera and said to him, "Come, my lord, come right in. Don't be afraid." So he entered her tent, and she covered him with a blanket. "I'm thirsty," he said. "Please give me some water." She opened a skin of milk, gave him a drink, and covered him up. "Stand in the doorway of the tent," he told her. "If someone comes by and asks you, 'Is anyone in there?' say no." But Hael, Heber's wife, picked up a tent peg and a hammer and went quietly to him while he lay fast asleep, exhausted. She drove the peg through his temple into the ground, and he died. Just then Barak came by in pursuit of Sisera, and Jael went out to meet him. "Come," she said, "I will show you the man you're looking for." So he went in with her, and there lay Sisera with the tent peg through his temple, dead. From the Song of Deborah, Judges 5, 24 to 27. Most blessed of women be Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite. Most blessed of tent-dwelling women. He asked for water, and she gave him milk. In a bowl fit for nobles, she brought him curdled milk. Her hand reached for the tent peg, her right hand for the workman's hammer. She struck Sisera, she crushed his head, she shattered and pierced his temple. At her feet he sank, he fell, there he lay. At her feet he sank, he fell. Where he sank, there he fell, dead.
Psalms 138. I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart before the gods. I will sing your praise. I will bow down towards your holy temple and will praise your name for your unfailing love and your faithfulness for you have so exalted your solemn decree that it surpasses your fame. When I call you, answer me. When I greatly embolden me, may all the kings on the earth praise you, Lord. When they hear what they have decreed, may they sing of the ways of the Lord. For the glory of our Lord is great. Though the Lord is exalted, he looks kindly on the lowly. Thought lawfully, he sees them from far. Though I walk in the midst of the trouble, you perceive my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of the foes with your right hand and save me. The Lord will vindicate me. Your love, Lord, endures forever. Do not abandon the ways of your hand.
See on the poor.
watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me. Why should we linger and heed not his mercies, mercies for you? Tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh, for that wonderful love he has promised, promised for you and for me. Though we have sinned, he has mercy and pardon. Tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Calling, oh sinner, come
I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. And you're the one that guides my heart. And Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ.
teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
It's my pleasure to be reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 8 to 11. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us as you help us by your prayers. Then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to the prayers of many.
Mark 3:1-6. Another time Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Stand up in front of everyone." Then Jesus asked them, "Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?" But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus.
Thank you.
We're going to continue in our worship by giving thanks to God for all that we have, be it little or much. God has given us breath. God has given us life. God has redeemed our life and promised us life abundant as we continue to seek to walk in His will and ways. And so as you know, the collection box is at the front, and you can leave your tithe and offering there either at the beginning or the end of service. And I want to thank particularly Wayne and Mary, who came out and ran our canteen yesterday at the, who ran our canteen at the very successful Artisans Fair. We had May there, and May seemed to be selling up a storm down there at the Vendors Fair. I also want to thank, just publicly and online, Barb, who is our neighbor. Barb and Frank came, and she really kind of took the lead on this and organized it. And we ran one last year, and it's just great to have people in the community who are helping and partnering with us in putting on these events. And so I'm really thankful to Barb and Frank. And we're thankful for you and for the ways that you give of your time and your talents and your energies to continue the ministries, both ministering to one another through coffee, card, and conversation, right? And by ministering to those outside of our community. Oh, potluck, not next Sunday, but the following Sunday. So lots of time to prepare lasagna. Nancy?
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
I thank you for sharing vulnerably and authentically your needs, your prayer requests, and your praises. And we rejoice with those who rejoice. We grieve with those who grieve. And we come together with, I don't want to use the word promise, but our commitment to continue to keep you in prayer throughout the week. Would you join me now as we bring those prayers that God has already heard, that God already knows, that God is already working together for good? Would you join me in prayer as we allow God to work in us? Gracious Creator, you have heard the prayer of your people. We thank you that you are already at work, that you are already preparing a place for Michelle. Here in Kingston, we pray, God, that she can remain close to Michelle, and may it happen sooner than later. We trust in your timing. And we pray that those who are doing the organizing will be receptive, will be paying attention, will take all things into consideration as this move is on the horizon. Lord, we continue to pray for Donna Rennick, that her transition into her new home will go smoothly. We continue to pray that as she prepares for that transition, those casts will come off her legs and she will experience healing and strength. And we thank you for her faithful witness and for the peace that she has carried through all of this. Lord, we continue to pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. And Lord, we ask that you would help them to grieve well, to feel those ebbs and flows and to bring them before you. Lord, we continue to pray for Miss Sue as she prepares for her knee surgery. And what a disheartening thing it was to learn that it was set back, but we pray that she will get a new date and it will be quick, and that you would give her peace as she prepares for that surgery, God, and that it would go without complication and it would have a complete and speedy and full recovery, Lord. We pray for John as he's in search of a vehicle, God. And you are Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides even for our practical needs, even for the little things, God. And so we just ask that you open his eyes and reveal to him, God, a vehicle that will allow him to continue to serve in the ways that he is serving in his job, and that'll be within his financial means, and be reliable, in Jesus' name. And Lord, we continue to pray for this church, your church. This is your church. And I am grateful that this is your church. Continue to make your presence known in tangible ways. Manifest your glory in ways that see people drawing closer to you, falling into deeper intimacy with you, drawing nearer to you, following you more closely. I thank you for the neighborhood that you have blessed us with, that you have placed us in, and for the symbiotic relationships that have and continue to be formed as we seek to bring blessings and flourishing to all. Increase our territory, Lord. Increase our territory that we might love more, that we might show more mercy and more grace, that we might reveal more of Christ to more people in the way that we live and we love. Lord, I pray for Ebby, God, and for Youth Unlimited, that you would continue to strengthen him, that you would continue to give him hope, and that you would continue to give him vision, God, for what you would have him do in the weeks and months and years to come, and that that ministry would flourish under his leadership, God. Lord, we pray for Nancy's dog. We pray for healing. Lord, we pray that they would find the right medication balance, that she would be comfortable. And we continue to thank you for each person who calls this their church home. For each person who considers King's Court their family, we give you thanks. For those who are gathered here today, for those who are unable to be with us, you know their hearts. And so may they continue to turn and seek your face. May they continue to know your grace. And may they find themselves drawing nearer to you. We thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the ways that you are ministering in and through us. We thank you for your mercy and your grace. And would you use us even more to bring glimmers of hope and healing and reconciliation and restoration? And Lord, as we enter into your word, may those gathered here today hear your words. Give us ears to hear, a mind to understand, the heart to receive, but most of all, the courage to allow ourselves to be transformed by the work of your Spirit. Thank you that you are with us as close as our very breath. Have your way, Lord. Have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. If we have learned anything from our series on Revelation, and I certainly hope that we have learned a few things, I hope that what we have learned most of all is the way of the Lamb. The way of Christ is not the way of violence and vengeance, but of co-suffering love. So as we dive into today's message, considering the story of another one of our sisters in Scripture, I have to admit that I find it difficult to reconcile the actions of the woman that we are considering today while not glorifying violence and vengeance. Jael, or Yael, appears in the midst of another story of one of our sisters in Scripture, the prophetess Deborah. Jael is a Kenite, married to Heber the Kenite, and the Kenites were a nomadic tribe of metalsmiths. She would have been a descendant of Horab, son of Jethro. And do you remember who Jethro was? Jethro was a father-in-law of Moses. Right, exactly. And we know that Jethro was the priest of Midian. So it's likely that the Canaanites were also known as the Midianites, or that at least they originally formed part of the Midianite tribe. And so Jael and her desert traveling family have parted ways with the rest of the clan, and they have set up camp at Zaananim near Kadesh. They had made an alliance with King Jabin of Hazor, who was a Canaanite. And so they could safely dwell here under the king's protection. But the Israelites around them have been enduring 20 years of oppression by the Canaanites. They've been enduring 20 years of oppression under King Jabin's rule. And now they're ready to go to war. And this is what is being played out in the book of Judges. Deborah, the prophet, has summoned for Barak, who lives in the region. He knows the situation. He knows the people. He knows the land. So he will serve as a good general under her command. She says to Barak that the Lord, the God of Israel, has commanded that he take 10,000 men and go to Mount Tabor to fight the Canaanites. Barak's response is that he will not go unless Deborah goes with him. Have you ever been in a situation where you feel like God is asking you to do something, but you put conditions on it? Have you ever had that, where you feel like God is asking, I'll do that, God, but if you show me this first, or if you give me this first, then I will do as you ask. Sure, God, I'll do that, but only once I have this in place. Maybe Barak was terrified. Maybe he thought that by suggesting this, Deborah would refuse and he'd be off the hook. Most likely, though, he probably felt that he needed Deborah by his side. As a prophetess, she could speak for God, and so he could go to her for guidance. He could go to her and find out what God's will is or what the next move was. And Deborah agrees to accompany Barak, but prophesies, saying to him that the victory will not be his. The glory for the defeat of Sisera, the commander of the Canaanite army, will go to a woman. Barak does as he was told, and they march in pursuit of Sisera. They march to engage Sisera's army in battle. They march to meet an army with 900 iron chariots. Do you see the contrast? They're marching. They're walking to meet this army that has 900 iron chariots. What chance do they have on foot against a proper army with military vehicles and might? Except the Lord threw Sisera's army into a panic, giving Barak and his army the upper hand. And so while the battle ensues, Sisera, recognizing that defeat is imminent, runs off. He runs away like a coward. Rather than stay and fight alongside his men, all of them who end up dying, he leaps from his chariot and flees on foot. He runs off to find refuge in Jael's tent, remembering that there was an alliance between the family of Heber, the Kenite, and King Jabin, the Canaanite. And Jael must have seen him coming, because she goes out to meet him. And she invites him into her tent, saying, "Come, my lord, come right in. Don't be afraid." That line arrested me. It made me stop. Come, my Lord, come right in. Don't be afraid. Why did she say, don't be afraid? Should she, a woman alone, with an army general at her door, not be the one who is afraid? Was she trying to encourage him to trust her? Her people were already at peace with his people. Was she mothering him, coddling him, comforting him? Don't be afraid. Was it all part of what she already knew she was going to do? Was it the beginning of the scheme that would bring about his end? He goes into her tent, and weary from the war, he lies down, and she covers him with a rug or a blanket. It's a word that's only used once in scripture, and it could mean either rug or blanket. And thirsty, he asks for water, but she gives him milk. Did your mother ever give you warm milk at night to help make you sleep? Milk had soothing qualities, like warm milk at bedtime. This clearly unrefrigerated milk would help to assure that Sisera slept deeply. And then Sisera tells her, just before he nods off, he said, stand at the entrance of the tent, and if anyone asks if there is anybody inside, or if any man asks if there is a man inside, say no. And really, there is truth to this, because this leader of armies is really just a child who ran off and is now being cared for by this surrogate mother, comforted, tucked into bed with some warm milk. Then as he lay sleeping, Jael took a tent peg and took a mallet in her hand and went softly to him and drove the peg into his temple until it went down into the ground. So it went through his temple, out his temple, into the ground. He was lying fast asleep from weariness, and he died. Again, Jael sees someone coming, and she goes out to meet them. It's Barak. And she says, come on in. I will show you the one you are looking for. Barak enters her tent. He sees Sisera dead with a tent peg in his head. So the Israelites gained the victory over Jabin's Canaanite army. But this victory was not won by a general or an Israelite or even a man. Rather, Deborah's prophecy was fulfilled, and it was a woman. Jael is the heroine. And there was, after this day, peace for 40 years. But my question is, why? Why did Jael come to the aid of the Israelites? Why did Jael betray the family allegiance to King Jabin? Why did Jael break the hospitality codes by taking in a refugee, making him feel safe, and then killing him? Hospitality codes were a huge law. And she broke all of the rules. Was she planning to detain him until Barak caught up, but then got worried that he might awake and her life would be in danger? And so she took matters into her own hand? Or was Jael like Rahab, a non-Israelite, loyal to Yahweh, sympathetic to the plight that the Israelites were facing? Either way, the victory was won. Jael's actions ended the war, gave the Israelites a victory, and began to usher in that 40 years of peace. But then we hear her story recounted again in Deborah's song, or perhaps better called Deborah's battle hymn. And it's recorded in chapter 5. And it offers another perspective. And as a side note, while there's no consensus, many scholars contend that this song was written before the narrative in chapter 4, that the song, that the battle hymn came first, and then the narrative was written after. So Jael's story begins at verse or stanza 24 of this song. And Dr. Shimon Bakan suggests that this abrupt interjection of Jael's story right here in the midst of this song serves as a sharp contrast between the Israelites who do not help their neighbors and the Canaanite or the Kenite woman who does. So the stanza of the song starts by referring to Jael as the most blessed of women, most blessed of women in tents. Here, Sisera asks for water. She gives him curdled milk, and then while he is still standing, she drives the tent peg into his temple, and he falls at her feet. Between her feet, he sank. He fell. He lay still. Between her feet, or between her thighs, he sank. He fell. Where he sank, there he fell dead. Listeners who heard those last two lines would have picked up on the sexual undertones. To lay still, to lay despoiled or destroyed, is a word that is sometimes used in the Bible to speak of a woman being sexually violated. So the contrast is that Jael has now penetrated Sisera and left him destroyed. Do you see the contrast? Sisera, who was destroying others, is now left destroyed. Now this gets some credence when we come to the end of the song, because Sisera's unnamed mother comes on the scene. Out of the window she peered. The mother of Sisera gazed through the lattice. Why is his chariot so long in coming? Why tarry the hoofbeats of his chariot? Her wisest ladies make answer. Indeed, she answers the question herself. Are they not finding and dividing the spoil, a woman or two for every man? Spoil of dyed stuff for Sisera, spoil of dyed stuffs embroidered, two pieces of dyed work embroidered for my neck as spoil. A woman or two for every man? It seems Sisera had a reputation. His mother's female attendants knew. His own mother knew. As his mom ponders with worry why her son has not returned home yet, she almost seems to comfort herself by saying, oh, of course. They would be dividing up the plunder of their enemies, the spoils of war. Those spoils of war that elevated her to a position where she has female attendants, where she can spear out the upper window of her home through the lattice. Spoils of war that contributed to her status and her wealth, which came at the cost of Israel's oppression. And she acknowledges, almost as matter of fact, and it wasn't unheard of, it was commonplace, that her son is delayed due to his raping and pillaging. A woman or two for every man. As Will Gaffney points out, there's no negotiations between families, there's no dowry, no consent takes place. These women are taken and used as wombs to produce offspring or simply as sexual objects raped for the men's gratification. Quoting Tikva Firmerkensky, a professor of the Hebrew Bible and the history of Judaism in the Divinity School at the University of Chicago. And I'm quoting from the Jewish Woman's Archive, the Encyclopedia of Jewish Women. The mother expects her son to be able to sexually violate captive women. Instead, he has become a woman's captive, and she has left him despoiled. Taking as Sisera's intent his mother's statement about female captives, by killing Sisera, Jael has prevented the rape of Israelite women. In the words of Wilda Gaffney, a dead Sisera lying still between Jael's feet can no longer abuse Israel's daughters by forcing himself between their feet. And the song ends with the refrain, so perish all your enemies, O Lord, but may your friends be like the sun as it rises in its might. A couple of things occurred to me as I read this story. The first is the idea of biblical womanhood. And this term, biblical womanhood, has taken a resurgence in the last couple of years. And the way that it's used is often in conjunction with patriarchy, complementarianism, where women stay at home, raise the kids, are submissive to their husbands, men are head of the household. There's been a resurgence. Women do not preach, women do not teach. And it comes under the banner of biblical womanhood. But I don't know about you. As we've unpacked all these sisters in Scripture, there seems to be a much broader view of what biblical womanhood looks like, doesn't it? It's not this narrow thing. Biblical womanhood is to follow God. It's to love God. The other thing that occurred to me, and I said this at the beginning, is that I find it really difficult to reconcile Jael's actions while not glorifying violence and vengeance. Now, I wasn't present when all this went down. I don't know the context or enough of the backstory. However, as I consider the narrative, one thing jumped out at me. Jael did not act in this manner for her own sake, but for the sake of others. She felt compelled to do something to see those who were being oppressed, those who were being abused, set free. And she did so at risk of her own livelihood and her own life. What would her husband think about what she had done? They were at peace with the Canaanites. Why would she jeopardize that? What would those in the tribe, what would those who were wandering in the wilderness with them have thought of her? Was she kicked out? Was she ostracized? Was she stoned? Did she have to live in fear of retribution the rest of her life? I have no idea. But I know that she did it for the sake of others. Was there another way? I don't know. Maybe she did the best she could with what she knew to do. But when we know better, we do better. Amen? When we know better, we do better. And what I do know is Christ has unveiled for us a better way. Amen? A way that still calls us, still commands us to seek justice for the oppressed, for the marginalized, for a way that makes peace, a way that is grounded in mercy and love. And then I was reminded of when Jesus stood up in the temple and read a passage that would have been super familiar to everybody there. He read verse 1 and 2 of Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And then he stops. Mid-sentence. In the middle of verse 2, Jesus stops, rolls up the scroll, and sits down. Everyone is looking at him. Like, buddy, we think you forgot something. We think you finished a little early. Like, what's happening? Maybe even for some, they were waiting for that part. That part they were waiting to hear, the part that would justify their own attitudes, the part that would justify their own actions. But Jesus didn't go there. He simply responds with, "Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Do you know what Jesus did not say? Do you know what the last half of that sentence of Isaiah chapter 61, verse 2 is? It continues on with the words, "and the day of vengeance of our God." Jesus edited out vengeance, closed the book on vengeance, took away our right to revenge. And in the same way, the divine vengeance has been closed on us, so we are to roll up and tuck away any of our ideas of vengeance against others. Amen? Even as we seek, especially as we seek justice and freedom and peace. Because hate cannot drive out hate, amen? Only love can do that. We cannot meet violence with violence and expect peace. We need to roll up the scroll on violence and vengeance. Because when we know better, we do better. And Christ has shown us better on the cross. Amen?
Dear friends, we are going to Jerusalem with Jesus.
He is our pardon, our healing, and our peace.
We will suffer the trials with him, resisting evil.
With him, we will walk the path to life.
But first, come to the table where there is food for the journey.
With hearts full of joy, we come,
giving thanks to God, our Maker. We are right to praise you, faithful God.
You answer sin with grace.
You guide our wayward steps toward home.
You are mending for the broken.
Safety for the poor, belonging for the outcast.
Strength for the weak and pardon for the sinner.
You reveal your kindness in every sorrow.
Your mercy even in death.
All your creatures see your works.
They sing your steadfast love.
We too declare your wonder and grace.
As with the angels and saints we sing, holy, holy, holy are you, God. We join in creation in glorifying you. Hosanna in the highest.
We are called on this journey to turn our lives to the Lord, to turn away from all those things which have harmed us and others, to separate ourselves from actions and attitudes that demean and destroy. It is far too easy for us to sink into the mire of self-pity and self-serving attitudes, wondering why everything isn't going our way. We want comfort, contentment, no stress, no struggle. Yet our lives are filled with stress and discontent. We hurt, Lord. We hurt in our bodies and our souls. We hurt in our relationships with others. How we must try your patience. We don't want to be like this. We want to feel the warmth of your love, the freedom of your spirit, the joy of serving you. Forgive us for our selfishness and self-focused. Heal us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us confess to our God, who waits to surrender us with grace and hope. O Lord Jesus Christ, we come, and we confess that we have sinned against you and others.
In our thoughts, words, and deeds.
We have failed to love our neighbors, and to varying degrees.
We have ignored your call to be a blessing.
Have mercy upon us, Lord Jesus. Forgive us for our lack of love.
And cleanse us of all unrighteousness,
that we may walk in your ways
and serve you in grace and love.
This we ask in your holy name.
Amen.
You are forgiven. You are given another chance. God has heard your cries. Turn again to the Lord. Find comfort and strength in God's eternal love for you. Be healed. Amen. You alone are holy. God, who laughs at our foolish posturing. And blessed is Jesus Christ, who came to tell everyone of your love. He could have remained seated in glory, but chose to walk with us down this path called life. He could have remained on the mountaintop, but came down to minister to all in despair's empty valley. He could have simply told us how we should live, but demonstrated genuine love by dying on the cross, so death's power might be broken by the grace of resurrection. As we rejoice in your hearts, beloved, as we would listen to him with our souls, we speak of that transfiguring mystery called faith.
Christ died, breaking sin's power forever. Christ was raised as love conquered death. Christ will return to gather all the beloved to God.
On the night of his arrest, Jesus shared a meal with his companions. He took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to disciples and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, he took the cup, blessed it, and shared it, saying, "This cup that is poured out is the new covenant."
For gladness in this bread and cup, for love that cannot die, for peace the world cannot give, for joy in the company of friends, for the splendors of creation, and for the mission of justice you have made your own. Give us this gifts of this holy communion, oneness of heart, love for neighbors, forgiveness of enemies, the will to serve you every day, and life that never ends. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Let us keep the feasts. God calls all people to the table of forgiveness, peace, and loving fellowship. We here at King's Court affirm an inclusive and open communion table. All persons, all ages, ethnicities, sexual orientations, abilities, denominational affiliations, and other distinguishing features are welcome to partake of this sacrament, which affirms that we are all part of God's family and are to commune together in sacred relationship. Faith in Christ, love, and peace are the uniting virtues of this spiritual meeting place. Therefore, all who wish to join in this act of unity are invited to do so, provided that you do so in the spirit of peace and love for God and one another. All you who truly and earnestly desire to abandon your selfish ways, who want poor attitudes, hurtful words, and destructive actions transformed so that you might be a better mediator of the blessings of God. You who are wanting to grow in love for God and others, who want to live in love and peace with your neighbors. You who are striving to walk in the will and ways of Christ, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and humbly make your honest confession to Almighty God. Come to the Lord's table, all you who love him. Come to the Lord's table and be at peace. As this next song plays, you're invited to come, receive the elements, take them back to your pew, and we will partake of them together once everybody has received.
Christ given for you, Dorothy.
Cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice.
Amen.
The body of Christ given for you, Wayne, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Eunice, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Richard, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Deborah, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. You're welcome. The body of Christ given for you, Miss BJ, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Amanda, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Robert, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. You're welcome. The body of Christ given for you, Joel, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Sue, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Rhonda, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Kathy, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Stephen, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Donna, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Bess, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice.
Thank you.
You're welcome. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Bonnie, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice. The body of Christ given for you, Miss Wilma, the cup of love poured out for you, rejoice.
Gracious Father, we give you praise and thanks for this holy communion. body and blood of your beloved Son. The body is broken, God's love poured open to make us new. Lord, make us new. Abba, Father, we bless your name and take part in this holy communion. Make us all one to love like your Son. The body is broken, God's love poured open to make us new. Lord, make us new.
Holy Spirit, come, make all things new. Bless this bread which you have given and human hands have made. Let it become for us the bread of life. Receive and rejoice.
All the walls that could divide us now broken down in Jesus. And though we are still different,
bless also this cup, the cup of love, the fruit of the vine, and the work of human hands. Let it become for us the cup of salvation. Receive and rejoice. Bless us also who eat and drink, that in this sharing we may know the living Christ, who is with us now and to the end of the age. Nourish us by these gifts to be willing servants in your world. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you, wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storms. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Go knowing the grace of God goes with you.
We were dead and helpless, now made alive in Jesus. He purchased our forgiveness, he makes us one. We will forgive in Jesus. Nothing shall separate us. He makes us one. We are yours, we belong. Every daughter, every son. We are one, we're the family of God. Rich and poor.